Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Now, this is a school that is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of his eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is the result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kenley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we use and teach by the true and original names and title for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. But we now know that each Lord must have a name, and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for Himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce a sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this day is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in his pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself, because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Now, we draw this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now, this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given us salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. Now he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in the school to prove that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this tour are as follows. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan is speak the truth. Tonight we have a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is 2 Peter, the 3rd chapter. And our scripture reading would be Dr. Bud Wunsch. And we'll have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good evening, class.
Good evening, Samuel.
Time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for making this place of the highest learning open and making our heart that we have the will of coming and learn your purpose and plan of salvation. And also whoever listen and hear this class of IDMR at large, everywhere where you are, think the time is getting closer. Mm-hmm. The closer you can ever imagine. The most you can learn, the best for you. Mm-hmm. You can be there in the kingdom. I say all those things and you only name Son's name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let's all say, hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
class.
Good evening.
Helps if I turn it on. Good evening, class.
Good evening.
Tonight's scripture will be taken from the third chapter of 2 Peter. And I'll be reading to you from the Holy Name Bible. This Bible is not a Dahway or King James. It's the Holy Name Bible, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts. By the late A.B. Traina, he happened to have been an Italian Jew, and he was with the Scripture Research Association Incorporated. This particular Bible was reprinted by Joshua Promotions. 2 Peter, the third chapter. This second epistle, beloved, I now write unto you in both, which I stir up your pure minds by the way of remembrance, that ye may be mindful of the words which were spoken before by the holy prophets and of the commandment of us, the apostles of the Redeemer and Savior, knowing this first, that there shall come in the last days scoffers, walking after their own lusts, and saying, where is the promise of his coming? For since the fathers fell asleep, all things continue as they were from the beginning of the creation. For this they willingly are ignorant of that by the word of Yahweh the heavens were of old, and the earth standing out of the water and in the water, whereby the world that then was being overflowed with water perished. But the heavens and the earth which are now by the same word are kept in store, reserved unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of wicked men. But beloved, be not ignorant of this one thing, that one day is with Yahweh as 1,000 years, and 1,000 years is one day. Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. But the day of Yahweh will come as a thief in the night, in which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up. Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conduct and righteousness, looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of Yahweh, wherein the heavens, being on fire, shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing ye look for such things, be diligent that you may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. And account that the long-suffering of our Savior is salvation, even as our beloved brother Saul also, according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you, as also in all his epistles, speaking in them of these things, in which are some things hard to be understood, that they that are unlearned and unstable rest, as they do also the other scriptures, unto their own destruction. Ye therefore, beloved, seeing ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from our own steadfastness. But grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Redeemer and Savior, Yahshua the Messiah. To him be glory both now and forever. Let us all say hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Okay, thank you there, bud. Okay, tonight's our workshop night. Okay, and without further ado, the first speaker will be the Dean of the Chair of my school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Good
Good evening.
Good evening, class.
Good evening.
It's always a pleasure and honor to stand before the assembly of Yahshua Messiah and testify of some of the things that Yahweh allowed me to see and understand about this great teaching. I was actually going to get into something else real simple until I read the scripture lesson. I thought I might hit on that a little bit since it came up. However, are there any questions before we get started? Because this is question and answer night. All right? Nobody got no questions? That's always good and bad. So, anyway, that was an interesting scripture lesson. There was a lot in it. And so I thought I might just go ahead and just dovetail right into it. Now, there are some things we need to set up when we get into the second epistle of Peter. For this reason, Peter points out this beast man of sin. If you weren't paying attention, you would miss it. All right? And we got to see the purpose coming down out of that garden, walking on through the ages and dispensations, that is, via the man. Now, when you look at this serpent, you know, and folks walking here, they see a snake. But what this serpent is representing is a principle. And that is the principle of the adversary that has been hid, or I'll say it like this, who have the ability to hide themselves from you by way of a veil. Alright? Now, Yahweh himself has provided an avenue and a way for us to see him and understand him as he really is and as he actually exists. Now let me have Romans 1:19 and 20, and I want you to also pick up your textbook. We're going to go to page, volume 4, page 11. We're going to hit that, and then we're going to dovetail into that scripture lesson, but I want to set this up before we get into that. Because at the end of the day, the reality is this. It's important that we all become conscious of who we are. And the reason we don't see who we are is that there is a veil, you see, which is the sixth step in our pattern that hangs in our conscience that we can't see. Because when we think of a veil, we think of a covering. You see, but when you are ignorant of a principle or ignorant of anything that has been presented to you, but you don't see the reality of it, then you got a veil. Example, someone tells you that they love you, but the manifestations say that they don't. But you believe that they do because they said it. But you're not translating what they really mean. You see, they may feel entitled. Or you may serve as a tool to achieve a certain goal in their life. Right. But deep inside, they don't love you. They just love what you do for them.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right.
Because you make their life simple and happy.
Right.
But what you're calling it is love. And it may be a very toxic relationship that you're in, but you want to believe that they do when all the actions and manifestations say that they don't.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying? Maybe I should draw that out just a little bit more. Now, since I said that, let me go ahead and pick that up. Pick up 2 Corinthians. That's 2 Corinthians? 1 Corinthians 2, just start at 2 and 1. I think that's what I want. And then we'll read down, then we'll get to the meat of this thing. Because see, when you read 2 Peter, what Peter is talking about, what happened back here in the antediluvian age, and the state and condition of the people that was in that age. Okay? Be mindful, we're talking about a man looking just like me and you, having the same life behaviors and disposition as these folks back here. When Yahweh appeared to Noah at the end of the age. And when he appeared to Noah at the end of the age, he told him what was going to happen, or he revealed to him there's going to be impending doom, at the end of the day, but I am holding you responsible. I'm anointing you to go out and talk to the people and warn the people about what's going to happen.
Right.
Now, at this particular time, they have not yet seen rain. So where Moses and where Noah get out talking about it's going to rain and this world coming to an end? What do they know about a world coming to an end? Well, we have the same problem and situation at the end of the post-diluvian age. They were looking for the end of the age. And what's going to happen? They was asking for a sign. So quite naturally, you ain't going to do nothing but the same thing. Here you are looking for the end of the age, or the end of the world, just like they were back here with Noah, back here when the Messiah showed up, and when the founder showed up at the end of the age. Okay? So when you look back at the whole thing, you see the sun, moon, and stars in this present kingdom age, and all things therein, even a man walking around. You go back in the post-diluvian age, and this world, this age came to an end, you see the sun, moon, and stars, and all things therein. You find even a man walking around in a physical body. And then you go back into the antediluvian age, you see the sun, moon, and stars, and all things therein, and that age came to an end. And guess what? You see a man walking around in the body. Then Peter talks about the end of heaven age in this present kingdom age. Y'all with me so far?
Right.
Now the question exactly, what is it and how it's going to happen, what's going to be made manifest? Because all the folks in the church world, they're looking for the end of the age, but they're looking for Jesus to come surfing in on a cloud to save them.
Right.
That's what they want.
Yeah.
And we've got pictures illustrating that Yahshua shall descend from with a shout. We talk about that all the time. Now the question is, what are you looking at? And what is Peter talking about? I wasn't going to go into this, but it came up.
Okay.
Y'all always running the show.
Right.
Yeah.
All right?
That's right.
Now, Romans 1:19-20, then I want to get 1 Corinthians, I think it's the second chapter, I want to make sure about that. But you can go ahead and start reading Romans 1:19-20, that's exactly what I'm looking for in 1 Corinthians. Matter of fact, it is 1 Corinthians, 2 Corinthians 2. We'll get to it, we'll start with holding it too. Okay, now let's go. Now keep in mind, we got the fall of Adam, right? Everybody know the story. I'm going to chop it up a little bit. You got Adam, who was deceived by his bride, listen, in the creative age. All right? And listen, Adam was in a heavenly state, not a heavenly place, but a heavenly state. Now understand this, there was a time you were in a heavenly state, but not a heavenly place. And interesting, there was a time you had no fault. In this respect, you couldn't talk, you couldn't take care of yourself, somebody had to change your diaper, somebody had to feed you, somebody had to teach you right, and had to teach you wrong, and indifferent, you get, somebody had to corrupt you.
Right.
And I'm letting you know the folks that raised you are the ones who did. And what you've been exposed to, that's all corrupt you. But there was a period of time when that spirit of the living Elohim that took up residence in you, I'm letting you know that spirit of the living Elohim has never, ever, ever been corrupt. But it's you who perverted
right.
and corrupted what spirit is and what the soul is because you don't know what it is. You can ask, survey. I'm talking about right out on the street. I'm going to say 100 people, maybe 1,000. Ask them what is spirit and what is the soul. I'm going to say about 98% of them don't know. And I'm going to say maybe even 100% don't know. You get the point of it? So they walk around in darkness and in ignorance because they believe what they've been taught
right.
or what they heard or what so-and-so said because they think he knows.
Right.
You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now let's read Romans 1:19-20 because the founder, you see, stressed this. Now this is the Apostle Paul speaking to us, come on us, in this present kingdom age. Now remember, there's seven ages and there's seven dispensations. Now don't leave This, just like you see it on the chart. Dispensations lead you back to dispositions.
Okay.
These are types and shadows to lead you to a reality. It's a schoolmaster to lead you up to, listen, the Messiah, the spirit of the Elohim who took up residence in that body and the personality of Yahshua Messiah. Okay. That's what this is all about. And we're using the scriptures as tools. We don't worship them. We just use them as tools,
right,
to come to a profound understanding of Yahweh's divine purpose, pattern, and plan that he set up and prepared or declared back here in the realm of eternity. This is simple stuff.
Because
I'm not going to blood, water, spirit you to death. I could. But I'm not going to. You're not here for that. You're here to find and know Yahweh as he really is and actually exists.
That's right.
And I'm talking about in the power of the resurrection. Mm-hmm. Talking about this one here, Yahshua Messiah, functioning as the Son in you. That's what it's all about. Mm-hmm. Alright? Mm-hmm. And I want you to see him in you as you. Mm-hmm. Not as you in him.
Right.
If that makes any sense. Some folks don't like that. That's okay too. Mm-hmm. That's not my opinion. That's a reality.
Really?
All right? Now here's Paul speaking to us in this present kingdom age. After the death, burial, resurrection, and the ascension and outpouring of the Holy Spirit in this present kingdom age. Mm-hmm. And the same condition of the man in this age is very similar to the same condition in the post-Diluvian age. It's very similar to the same condition in the antediluvian age as a result of Adam's transgression. Y'all with me? Let's move.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
Now listen, we read over that all the time because it's so easy. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. Them who? I'm telling you right now, it's the man himself. You. That's who he's manifest. If he's manifesting Adam, he has to be manifesting you because right. You listen, you look almost like the man Adam.
That's right.
Walk around in the body.
Right.
And it was Yahweh Elohim himself who took up residence in Adam, bringing the purpose down or bringing heaven down on earth. If that makes any sense in this respect. Can I have plate number 1 and 2? And we're going to sit it right here because I need this plate right now, plate 15. I don't know why I just take it and put it up here in the first place, huh? I should stop doing that. See, I like to use these plates for the whole purpose. Because see, the founder said this. He said that Yahweh Elohim is the whole brass band all by himself. Yeah. So it means the holder, the entire purpose plan of Yahweh is the couch within Yahweh Elohim. As a result of plate number 2, which should be here, he came from behind the veil of inscrutability or an incomprehensible and manifested as the Son of Yahweh. And the founder said that he's the whole brass band by himself.
Right.
The angelic and the material creation or the physical creation.
Amen.
So you got to see him and you got to understand the abstractness of Yahweh at the same time. Alright? So because that was made known of Yahweh, him, Yahweh Elohim, it is manifested in them. Why? Because it was Yahweh Elohim who took up residence in the man called Adam.
Right.
You with me so far? That's what he's talking about. Yahweh, in his ontological state of perfection, prepared and declared a purpose in the realm of eternity, being both vastly and infinitely within himself, making him the parent substance. It was him that gave birth to his son,
right,
or was Yahweh himself that incarnated as Elohim or as Yahweh Elohim. You see?
Mm-hmm.
The archetype or the original pattern of the universe. The pattern being the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit in the abstract state, and that you can't see him, he takes on shape and form or manifests as a spirit embodiment. Or he comes from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility into a shape and form whereby the man himself could see him, talking about him who?
Yahweh himself or communicate with him within his consciousness. What is consciousness? Consciousness is thought that is quickened. That's what consciousness is. You're awake. You're alive as a result of the spirit of the living Elohim in you, calling you to live and move and have your beings.
Yeah.
That's what this is all about.
Yeah.
Him and only him. In you and the power of the resurrection within your consciousness. You need to see him, not your bad attitude.
Right.
It is him that's going to get rid of your bad attitude and give you peace and solace.
Mm-hmm.
Alright? The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, that's what the pattern is in the abstract state. But then, in that Yahweh declare and purpose a purpose within the realm of eternity, and when he purposed it with you in mind, knowing that you would not understand him in his abstract state or in his ontological state of perfection, it behooved him to move from a state of abstraction into a state of incorporealization, or to an incorporeal state and condition whereby he can commune, or he talks, he speaks with the man himself. Now, before the creation came in, Yahweh was all of that and some, whatever you could think of.
Mm-hmm.
You see? But when he brought Moses up in the mountain here, y'all with me so far?
Yes.
Moses was invited up. He didn't just come up here because he felt like coming up there.
Right.
He was invited up, listen, by Yahweh himself, who was materialized as Hoshea or Joshua the son of Nun.
Mm-hmm.
You see?
Yeah.
Among the Israelites whom he created, for he made to go down while they was yet in bondage. As they're walking around in darkness and bondage, you follow me?
Yeah.
He was that light that was shining in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. I'm talking about Joshua the son of Nun, functioning as Hoshea the son of Nun. And the father side father was saying, that was old. He said, who was that guy right there? He said, that was old man Nun's son. But old man Nun was not, listen, one of the sons of Jacob.
Right.
He materialized down there 10 years after Moses made his exodus out of the land of Egypt. And he was orchestrating what's going on down here in the land of Egypt. Talk about Joshua the son of Nun.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this gospel is so good.
Mm-hmm.
When you see and understand. Nevertheless, Moses was invited up in this mountain and blacked out. You see, and Yahweh revealed or showed him, listen, his essence, his attributal makeup, Yahweh's attributal makeup, and Moses' attributal makeup. It was revealed to the man as he sees this spirit embodiment.
Right.
You got to get him understood. When he's understood, everything else is understood. You are understood when you understand your attributal makeup. Now, when Moses was invited up here, he sees the shape and form. So Paul says, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. Because the shape and form materialized at the first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and then he formed the man on the sixth day. I probably should take plate 11, 12. I ain't got nowhere. He formed the man on the sixth day. Put it right on that step up there.
I wish I could.
Oh, I'm sorry. You need a step stool. I'm sorry. I apologize. You need a step stool.
Some stilts.
I bring one from work, a step stool for you. And so it was him who took a residence in Adam. You see that heart right there?
Mm-hmm.
But you don't see that heart right there. Mm-hmm. No, you don't see it.
Yeah.
It's the same plate as right here. You see that heart in each plate? You see that?
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because this heart and this shape and form are one and self-same. Mm-hmm. And it was a man that presented first. We got him as a half man here. We got him here manifesting each day. And then the creation just materialized before Moses. Or Yahweh wrote it in his heart and in his mind. You see? Just like he wrote the wrote with his finger, the table stones, he also wrote in Moses' heart and in his mind. How you gonna remember all that stuff, all them doggone names? Unless Yahweh placed it in them.
That's right.
So now, because that was being known, Yahweh is manifest in them, them is the man. So now we got the kingdom right here on this chart. You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Nine principal attributes.
Right.
And couch in the kingdom, which is him. It ain't beneath him. It is him.
Mm-hmm.
Talking about Romans 14:17. It might be 17:14.
17.
But I think it's 14:17. I think that's what it is.
Yes. For the kingdom of Yahweh is not eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit.
Is not intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge being the supreme crown peaceful?
Yes.
Beauty, love, just beauty, love, justice, isn't that peaceful?
Yes.
Foundation, power, strength, isn't that peaceful?
Yes, it is.
But it's the kingdom, you see, which is righteousness, peace, and joy. That's all these attributes encouraged within the Holy Spirit. Righteousness, peace, and joy makes up the 12. And that there's 12 orders of angels.
Right. Yeah.
All right? You got 12 cranial nerves coming down out of your brain. Mm-hmm. You with me so far? What am I talking about? It is Yahweh who took up residence in the man. Therefore, because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifested in the man. You see? So we just didn't read over today. Read, please.
For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Read.
Being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
Now, what are the invisible things of him? Well, simply, intelligence, is that not invisible?
Yes.
Wisdom and knowledge, is that not invisible?
Right.
Beauty, love, justice, foundation, property, is that not invisible?
That's right.
Mercy, joy, peace, hope, is that not invisible?
That's right.
And I'm letting you know, those attributes that I just said, they're not up here, they up here, you just don't see them.
Mm-hmm.
Justice and love will give you mercy. The one that sits on the seat of authority, which is Yahweh Elohim, he's the one that dispenses mercy and grace. Because you know how we are. You know, we get into a fist fight, you're like, nah, we want to stomp, you know what I mean? We can't say get up and let's fight. We want to kick and stomp. Don't want to, because we want to make sure you don't get up. We do fight. You get the point?
Yeah.
Just no mercy.
Yeah.
My point is the man, Yahweh, take up residence. Now, the invisible things of him are the attributes that Paul's looking at. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world, what are you talking about? It was him,
right,
as Elohim, who materialized as every cosmographical structure of the universe, and as the founder said, as the material creation. So for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world, what do you mean? They're threefold, because he's threefold here, and when he takes on shape and form, he's threefold here. And before the founder took off the flesh, he put right up here on the chart, Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. You know why? Because some folks, back in the day, some of y'all was around, there was an argument about Elohim's in you. The Holy Spirit's in you. But everything was Yahweh. And then somebody would say, including Fido in the backyard. Who doesn't know that? let's get this straight. If Yahweh is the ultimate source, the immaculate substance, the limits and the bounds and the origin and the essence of all things, how can Fido in the big backyard not be Yahweh?
Right.
You say you're Yahweh, somebody said we're sore spot on back door. My point is, which I just told you that. If all things or everything emanates and proceed forth from the clouds,
right,
or from pure spirit, if you will,
right,
and Yahweh declared it in the realm of eternity. And when Elohim come behind the veil of inscrutability, he is a declaration of what Yahweh declared. What's so hard about that? My question is, where are you?
Right.
When this day come in, talking about me and Yahweh, being all arrogant because you think you somebody. Because you walk around the body with a name. All of a sudden you can't breathe it. You think you somebody. You got your own body. You got your big feet and all. You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
You better recognize that the only thing that is in existence, and I'm like it or not, it is Yahweh himself.
Right.
That's all that's in existence. Always has been, always will be.
That's right.
That's why the founder said, I'm Yahweh. He didn't say I was the only one. He said, I'm Yahweh.
That's right.
Don't be offended. So are you. I want to make sure you're included in that.
Yeah.
The difference is, I don't have a veil up and you do.
Right.
I translated that. He says, I'm conscious of it.
Right.
And you're not. Is that what he said?
That's what it says.
I don't have a veil. My veil has been removed. I know who I am, but the question, do you know who you are?
Right.
That's what it's all about.
Mm-hmm.
He said, somebody get mad at me because I said there's no you in the Yahweh. As if you don't know what I'm talking about.
Mm-hmm.
I ain't got nowhere. Now, try to get back to theory.
Yeah.
Now, we got Yahweh. We got material creation, and now we got Yahweh in him to get resident in the man. It's real simple. So he says, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. So when you look at the man, and you look at Yahweh on him, clearly seen that the man is a photostatic copy of Yahweh Elohim, who is the man of men. Or the, you understand what I'm saying?
Right, yeah.
The soul of souls. Because Yahweh took up residence and said man became a living soul. He's the soul of souls. He's the seed of seed. We talk. In contrast with Adam and his loins are all seeds of seeds. That's how we got here.
That's right.
Because he himself is the seed of seeds. It's just simple stuff. The difference is, we're in heaven right now, because that's where Moses is.
Mm-hmm.
He's caught up in the realm of eternity, and Yahweh showed him a vision. Mm-hmm. And gave him a revelation, how the creation came in by the pattern. Which is Yahweh himself.
That's right.
This ain't hard, this is easy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
That folks just don't get and don't understand. But this is the reality of what this thing is all about. And that you are what you're looking for. That's what I'm talking about. Now, in that we got Yahweh Elohim taking up residence of man, and the seed is here, now the seed is here. He's the king of kings. So now Adam has to be the king that's on earth. So Yahweh gave him dominion. Is that all
right?
Of the animal king and the bird king, because he's the king of kings. And listen, if there's kingdom, he's the kingdom of kingdom. Now they're being made manifest. Walk around in a body. In other words, it's the boss himself in the body and the personality of Adam. What's so difficult about that? It was Adam, I'll say it like this. It was Yahweh that declared that his name will be called Adam. Why? Because Yahweh is the parent of something. He's both fast and feminine within himself. It was him who gave birth to Yahweh Elohim. So he's a parent. So therefore he can declare what the name's going to be.
Sure.
Your kids, your family do the same thing. Your mom and daddy name you.
Mm-hmm.
If somebody, the neighbor say, y'all call him this, they got to agree to it.
Mm-hmm.
How do I know that? Remember when John was born? And Zachariah was struck dumb? Couldn't speak, he's right with a tablet.
Right.
Because of his disbelief that he's gonna have a child in his old age.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And his wife was barren.
Mm-hmm.
But Yahweh blessed Elizabeth's womb.
Right.
Blessed his loins.
Mm-hmm.
And here comes John the Baptist. or Johnny Mercer. Struck him dumb because of unbelief.
Yeah.
And for 9 months, 40 weeks, 280 days, whatever one do you, he couldn't speak and he couldn't talk. Here, round tablet. Show me nice, he had these nice tablets now. You get my point?
Yeah.
And what happened was, when the baby was the book says that when Elizabeth was ready, you follow me? And it was time. Mm-hmm. Here comes John the Mercer. And so, it's right here depicted right here on the chart right here. That says Gabriel, does it not? No, he ain't gonna read. It's there that says Gabriel.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's the high priest. That's Zachariah. Right. That's why that's depicted right there. That's not two low priests. I wanna get that straight.
Right.
Because when you're in the back, that's exactly what you think. When you look way back in the back, you see this illustration, you think it's two low priests. Mm-hmm. No, it's just Zechariah and Gabriel. And Gabriel heard his prayer that he wants an offspring. Mm-hmm. He wants a son. However, when it was time and he was dumb, the wife said his name's going to be called John. Is that right?
Right.
The folks in the camp said, listen, man, ain't nobody around here with no name like that. We don't need to call him John. We get off calling him John for.
I know.
Well, who the hell are you to tell me what to call my kid? You, who do you think you are? Come tell me what to call my son. And I already been told what to call the boy.
Yeah.
And he told me to call his name Yon Han. Yon Ken. Yo Ken. And John means love. And when he named the boy, he said, well, let's just ask Zachariah. He pulled it right with the tie. And even the right, his name going to be called John. His tongue was loosed.
Yeah.
Because now you know, talking about Yahweh is not slack concerning his promise. So therefore, he let him know, I'm going to strike you dumb until the child get here. But he was a witness to his wife that Gabriel told him what the child's name is going to be. Y'all with me so far?
Right.
But my point is, Yahweh already declared that way back here in the realm of eternity. And so when Yahweh took on shape and form and he took up residence in that, it was already declared. Yahweh set that up. Why? Because John is a forerunner to Yahshua Messiah. He was 6 months older than Yahshua Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that simple. We got a pattern we operate by. Now, for the invisible things in heaven and the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made. Even his eternal power. Go ahead and read that.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
His eternal power is Yahweh's ability to transmute from the abstract to the intermediate to the concrete. You with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
From the abstract to the intermediate to the concrete.
Let me just move this over here for simplicity's sake. This is how it's supposed to be.
From the abstract to the intermediate to the concrete.
Mm-hmm.
Just that simple. Can't see, by way of vision and revelation, and then in materialization.
Right.
Right here on the chart. Yahweh, Elohim, Yahshua. Take out the argument. He's all that in one spirit embodiment.
Right.
The arrangement of those attributes, that is his body. The substance that makes him up are the attributes. The purpose that's encountered within him is the soul of Yahweh. Everything that he is, what he was, what he will be, that's all there. He's the soul of souls.
Yeah.
And this is what took up residence in Adam. That's why he said, because that which may be known to Yahweh is manifest in them, because Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, been understood by the things that are made. Everything you see has been made.
Yeah.
And just after it has been made, it also has been unmade. Anything physical, all flesh got to go. Mm-hmm. It's already been declared.
Yeah.
All right? Now, you have no excuse why you should not know your creator as he really is and actually exists. Because this shape and form transformed into this threefold completely furnished tabernacle. All right? Now, for simplicity's sake, remember, look at the back. Most holy place. I'll just write it on the board. We're going to read for a minute. Remember when you read in the textbook, you don't get want to get lost, you get tangled up in the veils. You'll see A, you'll see B, you'll see C, you'll see D, and you'll see E. Y'all with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
That's what you're going to see in the textbook when you read. You see. A, and maybe she might lower this just a little bit. A is the most holy place. Everything in the most holy place, I'm talking about the Ark of the Covenant, the two archangels, and the, that's all relative to A. When it says 14A, it's talking about the most holy place. Then you got veils, right? Right?
Right.
But those veils they come down. You follow what I'm saying? And when they come down, the veil points to B. That's why it's right here at this line. Because you're coming from the most holy place to the holy place. We have it vertical here. But in reality, it is horizontal. We walk out of one room into the next, right? And why don't we even? So therefore, this curtain comes all the way down here. So that's B.
Okay.
Which is your second departmental veil.
Right.
The whole veil is B.
Okay.
But behind the veil is A. Y'all with me so far?
Right.
Because we're going to read in a minute. What about getting lost? And I want the folks at home, go get your textbook while we talk. So we can read. Now C, all right, that is the holy place. And all the content, that's the seven branch golden lampstand, that is also the table of shewbread, and it is also the altar of incense. In other words, everything you see in here is relative to C. So we got A, which is behind, which is the Ark of the Covenant.
Mm-hmm.
You got B, which is your second departmental veil. And you got all the contents in the holy place, the seven branch golden lampstand, the table of shewbread, and the altar of incense. That is C. You got D, which is at the door. Alright?
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, you have your court. The court, round about. All the contents. Your seven branch golden lampstand. The cup of holy and oil, which is at the door. The brazen laver. And of course, the altar of sin sacrifice.
Mm.
Yo, that's the pattern. That's what they mean by 14A, 14B, 14C, 14D, and 14E.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody get lost. All
right? Right.
Now, I think I'm going to squash Corinthians. I probably should read it, but go ahead and just read that. I want to get that since I called it. 2 Corinthians, 2nd chapter, 2 and 1. Because I made a comment in the beginning.
But I determined this with myself.
I'm going to apologize. 1 Corinthians 2 and 1. I apologize. This is Paul speaking in this age. This is what he says. And he's talking about himself, and this is something he says.
And I, brethren, when I came to you, came not with excellency of speech or of wisdom, declaring unto you the testimony of Yahweh. For I determined not to know anything among you save Yahshua the Messiah and him crucified.
That's all he knows. Read, please.
And I was with you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. And my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom.
You know, I didn't talk over your head. You follow what I'm saying? I was plain. I was simple.
Right.
Let's read.
But in demonstration of the Spirit and of power.
But in demonstration of the Spirit and power. You say one thing, then you need to manifest it by demonstration and the power.
Right.
Don't say one thing and then you act another way. It ain't the same. That's what I was talking about. All right? Read on, please.
That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men.
Now listen. I already told you. The man, I'm pointing here, but I'm talking about you too.
Right.
Is corrupt. Why? Because he has this puffed up, egotistical, misdirected personality that the founder introduced us to. That governs us while we try to maintain our image and satisfy our flesh.
Okay.
We are psychologically and spiritually dead. And what we want to do is to get rid of this corrupt man who have a multiplicity of theory, concepts, and opinions locked up within his consciousness. What he perceived to be genuine and real and authentic.
Right.
But there ain't but one righteous, and that is Yahweh Elohim himself. Righteousness just simply means without fault, without guilt, without condemnation. That's all it means. And there ain't but one who's without fault, without guilt.
Right.
And I'm talking about that is Yahweh Elohim himself.
That's right.
In the personality of Yahweh the Messiah. Get that understood. Y'all with me so far, right?
Yes.
Read, please.
That your faith should not stand in the wisdom of men, but in the power of Yahweh.
Now, keep reading.
Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect.
Read.
Yet not the wisdom of this age, nor of the rulers of this age that come to naught.
Now, I should stay over there. But since we have a chronology chart, we got to understand some things. I'm trying to get to Peter. Who call that? You call that scripture, right?
Mm-hmm.
You always pick good ones.
Mm-hmm.
I know they're all good, but you know what I mean, right?
Yeah, you do.
But see, I'm trying to get to 2 Peter. And wind this thing up. Now, read that one more time, God. One more time.
Howbeit we speak wisdom among them that are perfect, yet not the wisdom of this age.
Read.
Nor of the rulers of this age
read.
That come to naught.
Read on.
But we speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery.
Now we speak, talk about us in the school.
Mm-hmm.
We speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery. The wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery. The wisdom of Yahweh that is hidden in a mystery. What is the mystery? Well, what is this creation?
Mm-hmm.
Where did it come from?
Mm-hmm.
Where was I before I even existed?
Mm-hmm.
What is this spirit that's in me? What is this soul that folks are talking about? That's the mystery. That I have a soul that I can't put in my hand and look at it. I can't eat it. I can't touch it. The spirit, I can't touch it. I can't handle it. But it exists.
Right.
What's this air that's causing me to breathe it when it's not? I'm choking and carrying it on. You get the point I'm trying to make? It points to spirit.
That's it. Uh-huh.
When you don't have Yahweh in your life, I'm letting you know, it chokes you off. You're unhappy. You're irritable. Now, I'm not saying that when you get the Holy Spirit or become conscious of it, you ain't going to have no problems.
Right.
Matter of fact, that's probably where they begin. You might have more problems. But the difference is you have the ability and you're equipped to persevere because you understand your attribute makeup.
Right.
Folks say, I'm going over there. Go over there and see what the heck's going on. They don't have to go. You can go.
Yep.
Circulate, as they would say. Mm. What's wrong with that? You shouldn't do that? Well, maybe you should. At least examine it to see if it be so. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Now, keep reading, so we gotta get out of here.
But we speak the wisdom of Yahweh hidden in a mystery.
Read.
Which Yahweh hath ordained before the ages unto our glory.
Now, we already talked about that. Do that already. Let's read.
Which none of the rulers of this age knew.
Now, none of the rulers in this age knew. For this reason, they haven't had recipients of the Holy Spirit. You gotta be a recipient of the gift of the Holy Spirit to understand the purpose and plan of Yahweh from start to finish.
Okay.
And everybody don't have to come this way.
Mm-hmm.
Sorry about that.
Yeah.
You don't know what Yahweh gonna reveal to a man on his deathbed.
Right.
You have no idea.
Mm-hmm.
You don't know what Yahweh gonna reveal to a man who's in prison. Some of these guys go to prison, they get in solitude for a whole lot of years, and folks out here bitter, there ain't no room for bitterness. Because
yep.
They saw something when they was in that doggone prison.
Mm-hmm.
In that darkness, Yahweh, they got to go within.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to get you to see the universe and all things therein. Yahweh, Elohim, you follow that? It's all within you.
Mm-hmm.
Always has been and always will be. You keep thinking it's out there, you're looking at what? You better look for answers in you.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because your attribute of makeup governs you, teaches you, and it reveals to you. What are you talking about? Everything in the universe is a manifestation of these divine attributes,
mm-hmm.
including you.
Yeah.
That's the reality of it. You got to understand it. Come on, we look for answers in the plants. That's why we got antibiotics and all this stuff from the plant. We got different herbs from the plant because there's intelligence in it.
Right.
There's substance in it. Come on, folks, wake up. That's what it's about.
That's right.
Understanding who you are and what's out there. Tell me something that's not Yahweh. We can shut down. But don't get in my face and tell me that so is fodder in the backyard as if I don't know that. Insulting my intelligence here. When I just said everything emanates and comes from him, you said the toilet's bottom in the backyard. Like you said something deep and esoteric. Now, let's move so we can get out of here. Get back to where I'm trying to get to read. 9.
But it, as it is written,
eye
has not seen.
Now the eye have not seen.
Nor ear heard.
Oh, the ear have heard. Come on.
Neither has entered into the heart of man
the
things which Elohim hath prepared for them that love him.
Hey, listen, folks. Yahweh prepared a creation for you to walk in and to live in. He formed a body. He created a body for you and only you, for you to walk in and to live in that temporary tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
And listen, he made it to look just like him, and to reflect him, and everything that's in him is in you.
Ain't
that something? So you have no excuse.
Sure don't.
And the reason why you run from it, for one reason and one reason only, I'm sorry, your soul is corrupt. It has been corrupted by the world. Their theories, concepts, and opinions. We got over here. Let me play 37 when you get a chance. You ain't got to rush it. We're going to put it over here. Because this place is a manifestation of the gifts of the Holy Spirit operating within a man. I appreciate it. But you, with your egotistical, corrupt heart and mind, you want to roll with this. You want to roll with the Pope. Roll with the Protestants. Roll with the Jews. The Baha'i. You see? What's the Jamaicans call it?
Rastafari.
Rastafari and all that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Is it Aryan Nation? Well, you get you want to roll that way. Because somehow you're the twisted thing in your heart and mind and thinking, it's just like that.
Hebrew Israelites.
Yes. You get the point. We're trying to get you to see that when you remove the veil, you see the real you. It's always been the Messiah in you functioning, governing you. Alright? Volume 4, page 11.
Angelic transgression.
Here you go, Doc. All right. Angelic transgression. I've got to play 14? Okay, it'll come up here in a minute. Now we're going to read that for this reason. Volume 4, page 11. Now, what's the purpose of this? We're going to get to 2 Peter in a minute. I'm going to try to get there by at least 9 o'clock, hopefully. If I just be quiet, right? Now, what's the purpose of that? With this plate or this chart, the map chart or the Daniel chart, whatever one do you, it says, proving the existence and destruction of Satan and his angels through the dispensations and ages. In this school, you got to know what an age is. An age is approximately 2,000 years. Mm-hmm. Give or take a few. Mm-hmm. You got to understand what a dispensation is. It's a divine order of affairs. You see, you got to understand what angels are. They are ministering spirits. They are expressions of Yahweh. Mm-hmm. Their duties are honor, serve, and obey Yahweh. Honor, obey, and glorify Him, right, and only Him.
Right.
You got to understand who Satan is. Well, when these angels fell, his name was changed from Lucifer to Satan. He became Satan, but he was Lucifer.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So if you don't understand that, this chart means nothing to you. And we're proving the existence and destruction of Satan. Because of the Yahweh that brought him in, but it's also Yahweh that took him out.
That's right.
That's what I'm trying to get you to see.
Mm-hmm.
Now, we got angels painted on the chart. Just so you know, angels don't look like that. But since you know how we are, that's what we've been raised up with. Mm-hmm. So we put up here on the chart, say, oh, it's an angel. But they don't have wings. They're painted with wings to show forth flight.
Mm-hmm.
Come on, man. We can pick up the phone and call anybody up tomorrow on the other side of the globe.
That's right. Yeah.
That's flight.
That's right.
Yeah. You get the point I'm trying to make? Sometimes I can be thinking something in my heart, my mind. You can be the other side. You can be at home.
Mm-hmm.
And for some reason, I may call you and say, you know what? I was just thinking about you. That's because you summoned me.
Mm-hmm.
We don't look at it that way. I was just thinking about you about 3 seconds. Yeah. We summons one another.
Mm-hmm.
We don't talk like that, but that's the reality of it.
Mm-hmm.
Not no coincidence.
That's yes, right.
Because we have energy, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the fall of Adam.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the man. And then that black ball is right there on the tail. You see that? And that black ball is walking on out of that garden, on down through the ages and dispensations.
Mm-hmm.
You get my point? Don't think of a snake, think of a man.
That's right.
Don't think of a snake, think of a man. It starts with, got a man here, got a man here, got a man here, got a man here, you got a man here.
Right.
What do you mean here? You got a man in the garden, you got a man with Noah, you got a man with Tower of Babel, you got a man with Abraham, and you got a man with Moses.
That's right.
But we got a snake coming all the way down, showing you that death reign from Adam all the way down to Moses. And that old satanic spirit was in the garden, but he also came right on out of the garden.
That's right.
And took a resident of the man and walked with him at the serpent. Come on, folks.
Uh-huh.
It's that simple.
That's right.
But we ain't talking about no dog on a reptile. We talking about men walking around acting like a dog on a snake. Sneaky. Have one agenda. Satan will present one way, and then they have a different agenda.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
We're talking about discerning and recognizing spirits in each other.
Right.
Or who are?
Yeah.
When you look at his counter, you say, something's wrong with him. He's bothered.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're acting funny.
Mm-hmm.
Or they're depressed.
oh, he's happy, or he appears to be happy, but is I don't know. He ain't the same. He's just presenting like that. There's something else going on. You get my point?
Yeah.
This is the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. We discern spirit of man. Now, let's read before we mess up our time.
Plate number 14 illustrates the angelic transgression, showing Satan, an evil spirit creature cast out of heaven into the earth, as compared to the threefold pattern of the tabernacle, plate 1. Beginning with the most holy plate, plate 14A is a type of heaven.
Now, we talked about that already, right? This is 14A. Go ahead. This is angelic invisibility. Lucifer is an incorporeal being. Meaning he can only be seen by way of a vision and a revelation. It's just that simple. Let's read.
As heretofore stated, the invisible angelic realm was first created before the physical creation. It was here that Lucifer or Satan was first one of the anointed cherubims or angelic spirit, the wings of which covered or overshadowed the mercy seat or the throne of Yahweh.
Read.
This is compared to the most holy place in the pattern of the tabernacle, a type of heaven.
Now, let me say this, since I got this out here right this year. I'll borrow this over here for this over here for a second. I'm going to slide this down here for a minute and put this over here. Okay, we got a pattern here. A, B, C, D, E. All right?
Mm-hmm.
Now, the angelic host or the incorporeal was created first before the material creation. That's all that is saying.
Right.
All right? Simple. All right? This is abstract, intermediate, concrete.
Right.
Most holy place, court roundabout. 1, 2, 3, A, B, C. It's just that simple. All right? Let's read, please.
Plate 1A, with the Ark of the Covenant therein and the mercy seat thereon, overshadowed by the two archangels, which is figurative of the throne of Yahweh.
In other words, Father, Son, Holy Spirit makes up the throne of Yahweh. That's all they're saying. And it was Yahweh himself who sits on the seat of authority.
Right.
Listen, not Lucifer. Never have and never will be.
Right.
And listen, the world or the globe need to get that understood. Satan has never sat on your throne, although folks think he does. My question to you, when are you going to get off? And who's going to take him off?
Really?
Because it ain't going to surely gonna be you. Because you don't even know he's there.
That's right.
If he was there. And I'm letting you know that Yahweh himself always sat on the throne and always will sit on the throne and will not trade places with any angel on earth. Or in heaven. He's orchestrating everything from the throne. Let's read, please.
Coming through the dividing veil, plate 14B, Lucifer or Satan was cast out of the third heaven or most holy place into the second heaven or holy place.
Now here's Michael. You see that? That's Michael.
With the sword.
Casting out Lucifer, who is the first one out. And these angels here follow him out.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what this plate is. From plate A to the veil, right, which is B, and to plate 14C. All right? Let's read, please.
Or from 14A to 14C, which is the intermediate state in the unfinished heaven and earth in the beginning of the physical creation.
That's the intermediate state. This is the angel, to my Elohim. He is the angel of all angels. All right? And he is the one that created the entire angelic host. And I'm talking about an innumerable company of angels. Y'all with me so far?
Mm-hmm.
Let's move.
where the life or spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
So we got that depicted right here. We also got it depicted right here on the plate here, on your Moses chart, how the spirit of Elohim moved on the face of the deep. Now you see that dove there? The dove and Yahweh Elohim and the heart, they're all one and the same. You got the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. You got a dove right here. You got a dove over here. There's a dove here and a dove here. But it's all symbolic of the Holy Spirit. Or the Spirit of the living Elohim. You with me so far? Let's read, please. It's a principle. Let's read.
Elohim moved upon the face of the waters in the ethereal darkness, and the darkness, which is Lucifer or Satan, comprehended it not.
Now, we got that depicted right here on the chart. As Lucifer is coming from 14C through 14D, which is the door here, into the ethereal darkness, that is 14E. And you got Lucifer right here, and his angels that were up here who followed him out in the earth without a body.
Right.
A physical body. Wait, he has an incorporeal body. Come on, folks. As long as you're in your mama's womb, taking on shape and form, he ain't gonna bother you.
Right.
And when it's time, when she's ready to pop or give birth, right? When you come out there, he got a body to get into.
Right there, you know.
Now let's get this understood. Lucifer is the perversion of righteous principles. That's it. All this stuff about wings, body, and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
He is a perversion. When you pervert intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge, that is a manifestation of the adversary.
Right.
When you pervert beauty, love, and justice, that's a manifestation of the adversary. When you pervert it. When you pervert foundation, power, strength, it's a perversion of these righteous principles.
Okay.
That is the manifestation of Satan.
Okay.
Here is in his, I'll say it like this, in his righteous state.
Mm-hmm.
Never leaves it. But then you pervert it in your mind about what beauty is. That's why I say beauty is only in the eyes of the beholder.
Right. Mm-hmm.
What you call beauty, I may not think it's beauty.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But it still is. Mm-hmm. You get the point I'm trying to make here?
Mm-hmm.
What I may be calling power, you may not call power.
Right.
But I tell you one thing, somehow that grass comes through that concrete.
Yeah, it does.
That takes some power too, doesn't it?
It does.
Mm-hmm. But it does.
Mm-hmm.
Don't make no difference how you get through there. Get through there. You can even put your hand through there.
Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
Look free.
And the darkness, which is Lucifer or Satan, comprehended it not. This transformation from invisibility to incorporeal form made it possible for him to appear in a vision to Eve.
Now, where are you reading that? Because I am. Are you on page 11?
Yes.
Okay.
Last two lines.
I got it now.
Moses and the prophets, in the same way that the righteous angels appeared to Abraham, Jacob, and others.
So basically what they're saying is short. When Lucifer or when the angels come from the angelic invisibility out into the holy place,
right?
This is angelic visibility. They're invisible, but they're visible.
Right.
In other words, I'm gonna say something. I'm gonna state an object. Now I'm not gonna say what it is as of yet.
Mm-hmm.
That's angelic invisibility.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
All right. I'm talking within you.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to say apple. An apple popped in everybody's head. It could be a green apple, it could be a red apple, it could be a yellow apple, you get my point,
right.
Okay? But the point is, now you have an image
right.
within your consciousness,
right.
within your soul about an apple.
Exactly.
That's angelic invisibility, although the apple is not in your hand.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But when the apple is in your hand, I'll say it like this, as Yahweh Elohim materializing to
You see, the vegetation on the third day, now that's a manifestation, that's angelic visibility.
Okay.
Or let me say it like this. In this state, because nobody saw this but Moses in that state. But it was a reality in the flesh. Am I making sense here? When Moses was down, before he went up in the mountain, he already was familiar with water and vegetation and animals and the man. He understood all that.
Right.
So when he get up here, he just sees the origin or a rerun of how it was assembled or how it was made manifest.
Okay.
Or Yahweh created it.
Okay.
But this is the heavenly state. This is the earthly state.
Right. Okay. Makes sense. Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
Mm-hmm.
All right?
Yeah.
So, we got him down here. All right?
I know it's here.
There it is. Uh-huh. Now, here Yahweh. He puts the man in a deep sleep right here. Mm-hmm. Right? He put the man Adam in a deep sleep because the man was formed from just earth. Spirit, soul, spirit, soul, and body.
Mm-hmm.
This is the spirit. Mm-hmm. And Adam was formed from just the earth.
Mm-hmm.
The man became a living soul. You see? Mm-hmm. And the spirit of the Elohim orchestrated all that.
Mm-hmm.
So the man makeup is spirit, soul, and body. Anuma, psyche, soma. That's the makeup of the man.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now the woman is a couch within the man. You don't see her, but she is there.
Mm-hmm.
Every man in this room has male and female DNA or seed within their loins.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about the XY chromosome.
Right.
And the X chromosome, you follow me? Whereas the female, she only have X chromosomes. But he has male and female to let you know that you are male. And Adam set that thing up. The woman's drawing out of a man. And when Yahweh put him in a deep sleep, this is carry or showing forth that she was encountered within him. Yahweh, and the book said, immersed, woman immersed in Yahshua or in Adam. You follow me? That's who that was. This is the first Adam. Or this is the Holy Spirit taking up residence in him because the name of this Holy Spirit, like it or not, it is Yahshua.
It is.
That's why he said, when you see me, you see the Father. Because me and my Father, we're one.
That's right.
And so when he died, buried, and he resurrected, he was still Yahshua on earth as he was in heaven.
Right.
But see, he was showing for, you see, him being in his commonness state and condition, in a humbling state and condition. You see, then he died willingly, willfully, whatever one do you.
Right.
You see, he gets buried in Joseph's new tomb and then resurrects a quickening spirit. You see, and listen, when they recognize him, talk about the resurrected Yahshua Messiah, they knew that was Yahshua Messiah.
When they resurrected, would that be the Elohistic state?
With who? In this state and condition?
Yes.
Yes.
That's what they were seeing from what they had been told. That would allow them to recognize who he was.
Let me say this. I gotta say this. I'll say it this way. Elohim do not look like this. This is a pictorial illustration of Yahweh Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
But you can't see intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge.
Right.
Even in an incorporeal state and condition.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yahweh had to appear as a man to create a visual. And the founder said it like this. He said, when Yahweh presented himself to me in a vision, he appeared, listen, as a man. I will be what I will to be, but I chose to appear as a man.
Mm-hmm.
Something that is familiar with the man's structure.
Mm-hmm.
One that he talks to on a regular. You don't talk to no heart, at least you don't talk back.
Mm-hmm.
You see, even though I did love Mr. Ed.
Yeah.
You see, but the point I'm trying to get you to see is this, is that Elohim does not look like this in reality.
Right.
Although we think that, Elohim is intelligence, wisdom, and knowledge. Beauty, love, justice, foundation, prosper, which you cannot see. But in that, Yahweh, listen, the Father, come from behind the veil of inscrutability and incomprehensibility. This is Him in His creative state. So when you dream, you see a visual of what you see out there. So when Moses is having a vision, I'm talking about in the burning bush, he sees an angel in the bush and looks something like a man. Because that's what he's familiar with.
That's right. That's right.
So when Yahweh brings the children of Israel, I'm talking about on top of Mount Sinai, Aaron and everybody, and 70 elders, they see the shape and form, something that looks like a man. Feet, body, and hands. But in reality, what they're looking at is a reality or a projection of themselves or their attributal makeup.
Right.
That's what they don't see and understand.
Right.
That's the reality. However, Moses was privy to see the tabernacle pattern, which is an explanation of the shape and form. There is no way for Moses to understand or the founder to understand the shape and form without this pattern right here. The pattern is a reflection of Him. And there is an order of service within the pattern. Because there's an order of service in this pattern here. He told him to make one a replica. Just like the one he said, because they're going to be an order, they're going to worship me upon this mountain. So Moses was made to understand, listen, he was made to understand how the creation was a symbol by pattern. I said he was made to understand. And Yahweh put that in him. And he showed him the creation as threefold as it was a symbol by pattern. And then He gave him divine specification on how to build and construct this tabernacle pattern exactly like he showed him up here in the mount.
Yes, sir.
So when he comes down out of the mount, you didn't see him walking down there with a tabernacle and he didn't have no blueprints in his hands.
That's right.
He was the blueprint.
Yeah.
We are all the blueprint.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Listen. See, mankind can be real cruel.
Mm-hmm.
See, we use rats and monkeys and orangutans and pigs and stuff like that to do experiments on, right? And every now and then they do it on us. They just don't tell you about it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
They like to get the scum of the earth, what they call them. Y'all heard about them guys back in the 30s when syphilis became very prevalent.
Right, right.
Those guys in prison.
Yeah.
They want to know exactly how this drug is going to work, what's going to happen when they inject them, and they just inject them to see what's going to, and they studied them.
Yeah.
But nobody ever knew nothing about it.
Yeah.
You get the point I'm trying to make?
Yeah.
And I'm saying that went on, and whether you like it or not, it's still going on.
Right.
We just don't know about it. It's covert.
That began in England.
Say it again?
That began in England.
Yeah, probably did.
Benjamin Franklin was experimenting with men's bodies.
Okay. My point is, it's going on then. Don't think it's not going on now. It's just a quiet operation. And I'm going to tell you this right now. Pharmaceuticals, they be doing all kind of testing.
Yeah.
But at some time, you got to test it on a man.
Yeah.
And once they test it on rats, I'm talking about these studies they do, they send out, they summons. They say, we need some volunteers.
Yeah.
We got studies with this new drug for the heart or for whatever. Mm-hmm. And we need some volunteers to be guinea pigs for this study.
Prisoners and exclusive.
Yes. But we need people. We need real people. We need some human beings. Subjects, if you will,
yes, subjects.
To be a volunteer for this drug.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Now, I'll say this. When they came out with Viagra in the 1990s, that drug was made to be a blood pressure medication. That's what it's for. Yes, that's exactly what it's made for. However, when they did the study over a couple of years, a lot of guys didn't want to come off of it. You see?
Yeah, you're right.
Because there was always a rise.
Yeah.
They're always popping a woody. You see? So what happened, they liked it because their nature was elevated. You see? So what happened was, when they found that out, they didn't use it for high blood pressure. They used it as an ED drug.
Right.
Yeah.
And that's how they marketed it.
Yeah.
The drug.
Yeah.
You with me so far?
Yeah.
However, it will lower your blood pressure. So they tell you, if you're taking nitrates, you see, that, don't take that with that drug, because it's going to lower your blood pressure too much. And next thing you know, you'll be being hauled off by your pharmacy to the ER because your blood pressure didn't bottom out because you got too excited. Okay, that's what I mean to get into that, but y'all get the point, right?
Yeah.
Now, where was I? Get back to the textbook. Let's pick up the thought. Read on down.
Oh, we were on back then, the page 11.
Okay, go ahead, read that down.
Okay. This transformation...
We're on page 12.
12.
Okay.
Number 12. This operation is compared to coming through the dividing veil, plate 1B, to the holy place in the pattern of the tabernacle.
Read.
Plate 1C, the intermediate state where the light from the golden candlestick burned throughout the night, representing the light or spirit of Elohim moving upon the face of the waters, and the light that shined in ethereal darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. Finally, passing through the door of first veil, plate 14D, we come to the outer court, plate 14E, which reveals the division between invisibility and visibility, signifying this spirit, Lucifer, was cast out into the earth where we find him, plate 14C to 14E, describing as the serpent that appeared in the Garden of Eden and was seen by Moses after the finished creation and later became incarnated in the man, Cain, Adam's son. This is compared to the outer court in the pattern of the tabernacle with the services performed for sin atonement.
Okay, read on.
If we are to prove that this invisible angelic spirit creature, Lucifer, and his host was cast out of heaven into the darkness in the beginning of the physical creation and later appeared in the Garden of Eden as described by Moses, who saw him in the vision while in the mount, and later incarnated in man, then we should be able to look at the visible manifestation in the beginning of the migratory pattern.
Now that's why I have Romans 1:19-20 for it. Because it takes the natural to understand the spirit. Now when we're looking at this plate right here, this is in the heavenly state that this is being seen. We got to get that understand. Remember, Joshua the son of Nun invited Moses up into the mountain. But it was also Joshua the son of Nun who was narrating Genesis to Moses.
Okay.
Even though Moses was telling the vision to the people when he came down out of the mountain, Joshua the son of Nun, he didn't say squat. He was here, he was sitting there listening among all the people and listening to what Moses said. When Moses went up in the mountain on his first trip. What you read in the first book of Genesis. Now, when Moses tells the vision, what you read in the first chapter of Genesis, Joshua son of Nun realized that Moses did not tell all that he saw when he was in the mountain. It just said a man was made in his likeness and in his image, and he gave dominion over the earth plane. So he already knew he's going to take him back up here the second time because he then broke the dog on the table of stone, and he needed a table of stone to put in the Ark of the Covenant. So he already knew he was going to bring him back up here a second time, show him the vision again, the 7 days. You see? But this time he's going to show him the transgression that took place in the garden. You see? With Lucifer. But he also going to see the genealogies and the pedigrees that's coming out of that garden, that is, by way of Adam, because we were all in his loins. Now get this understood, and please understand this. Yes, we all died in Adam. But we lived in Adam before we died in Adam. And that is our origin. Your destination is your origin. So therefore, Adam was not always in a psychological, was not always psychologically and spiritually dead. He was in that body, and let me tell you, he was in a heavenly state. That's why I said when you come in, you have a, you're in a heavenly state. Until, of course, you get out here and get corrupted. That's what happened to him. Here she come after she been deceived, and she give the fruit to him. Now, he was already told, you got to be fruitful and multiply. You can't multiply without her. So the purpose had to come down. And Adam had to bring the purpose down. And guess what? She followed him out just like the angels followed Lucifer out of the garden. And when she followed him out, guess what? Here come Cain and here come Abel. They're being fruitful multiplying. That's what they're doing. And that multiplication took place with Cain, even though he was a vagabond. When he left by himself, he going on by himself, his sister came with him. Which we have depicted, not on this plate, it's on plate 16, but we ain't got to get it. And then he populated, you see, the earth. Then 6 generations later, here come Nimrod, who was the descendant of Cain. And everything we learn from Cain, Nimrod adapted that as well and perfected it. Come on, folks. We got phones coming out every year. You know why phones come out every year? Because of your greed. What else is it? You ain't satisfied with the phone you got. Then make another one and do something that this one can't do. It ain't much different. You know what? You go on and spend more money. Well, ain't nothing wrong with the phone you got.
That's right.
Because this one here has a better camera. This one, you don't know the difference anyway.
That's so true.
It ain't that much different. The pictures look the same. You know, if you can't tell, oh, this is a better picture than that one. Now, if you went back way back when they first started, but they perfected. There's not been, there's not much difference between the 8 and 10, the 8, 9, and 10.
That's right.
They didn't make it just a little bit different to charge you an extra $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, $6,000, or whatever they're going to charge.
That's cool. Yeah.
But because of your greed, and because of how they corrupted us with a phone. And then half of them don't know how to use it anyway. But we want this real big expensive phone. My young boy, he got a flip phone. That's all he got. He ain't getting nothing else. He don't need no dog on the internet. Flip phone. Just, you know, flip it. You know, but there is no photos and can't surf the net and all that. He can just text and talk. That's it. Which is all you need. That's what it was designed for the first doggone place.
That's right.
Y'all get the point. Now, read this down a little bit more. We're going to talk somehow with the second Peter. I'm trying.
Okay.
Where you at? Well, I mean, where are you?
If we are to prove that this...
Okay.
No.
That's the second paragraph.
Yeah.
Go ahead and read it.
Okay. If we are to prove that this invisible angelic spirit creature, Lucifer and his host, was cast out of heaven into the darkness in the beginning of the physical creation, and later appeared in the Garden of Eden as described by Moses, who saw him in the vision while in the mount, and later incarnated a man, then we should be able to look at the visible manifestation in the beginning of the migratory pattern, shown in plate 13 with Satan incarnated in Pharaoh, the typical beast of sin, and his host
in Egypt. Go back and read that again.
The typical beast man of sin.
There we go.
And his host in Egypt, the outer court, before and after the stigit night of the Passover.
Read, please.
Thereafter, Pharaoh and his host were overthrown in the Red Sea. This was also confirmed by John in his vision while on the Isle of Patmos and is recorded in Revelations, which reads, "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels was cast out with him." John further confirms this in Revelations as follows, "And I stood upon the sands of the sea, and I saw a beast rise up out of the sea, mm-hmm. having 7 heads and 10 horns, and upon his horns 10 crowns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy."
Read on.
"This abased, self-exalted, evil, angelic spirit creature incarnated in a man is further typified in the scripture by the king of Babylon referred to in Isaiah 14:12, which reads, "How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which did weaken the nation?" And again, he is referred to by the prince of Tyrus in Ezekiel, thusly, "Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of Elohim. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardis, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day or eternity that thou was created.
Read.
Thou art the anointed cherub that covereth,
uh-huh.
and I have set thee so.
Read.
Thou was upon the holy mountain of Elohim.
Mm-hmm.
Thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire.
Uh-huh.
Thou was perfect in thy ways from the day that thou was created,
mm-hmm.
till iniquity was found in thee. By the multitude of thy merchandise, they have filled the midst of thee with violence.
Read.
And thou hast sinned.
Read.
Therefore, I will cast thee as profane out of the mountain of Elohim.
Uh-huh.
And I will destroy thee, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire.
Come on, read.
Thy heart was lifted up because of thy beauty.
Read.
Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness."
Self-exaltation. That's all he's saying.
Mm-hmm.
Read, please.
"I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may behold thee."
In other words, the Pope, he can go anywhere he wants on the globe. They rule out the red carpet for him.
Mm-hmm.
All right, let's read on.
"Thou hast defiled thy sanctuaries by the multitude of thy iniquities, by the iniquity of thy traffic. Therefore will I bring forth a fire from the midst of thee. It shall devour thee, and I will bring thee to ashes upon the earth in the sight of all them that behold thee. All they that know thee among the people shall be astonished at thee. Thou shalt be a terror, and never shalt thou be any more."
Now, if you noticed, in the reading, she mentioned several men. She mentioned Yahweh incarnated in Pharaoh, the king of Tyre,
mm-hmm.
right?
Mm-hmm.
Then, who was the other one? There was about three more. I mean,
Satan.
He and I had them all in my head. Pharaoh was one. Tyre was another. You follow me? But it was Cain, all of them, Nimrod. My point, there's a man that he incarnated in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That's the point I want to make. Without a body, he can't do no harm. He needs a body to do the harm or to wreak havoc.
Mm-hmm.
Read the last part. Yahshua Messiah.
Yahshua the Messiah, who was Yahweh Elohim that created all things.
Including fighting in the backyard.
Right. Incarnated in the flesh,
read.
Said, "I beheld Satan as lightning fall from heaven." This satanic spirit was revealed to the Apostle John as a dragon or serpent, of whom he wrote thusly, "And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast out into the earth, and his angels was cast out with him. I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, Now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Yahweh and the power of his anointed. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our Elohim day and night."
All right. I love it a little much.
Hallelujah.
But I wanted that read for this reason. I wanted you to see how Lucifer is able to operate when he cast out of heaven to the most holy place and to the holy place. His name was changed from Satan to Lucifer. I mean, from Lucifer to Satan.
Mm-hmm.
You see, into the outer darkness or the ethereal darkness. And the only thing he is doing is waiting on a body to get in to wreak havoc.
That's a shame.
Now, what's ever going on within heaven is being made manifest on earth. This chart depicts and so forth represents the greater and more perfect tabernacle. And we start with the track of the children of Israel coming to the divided waters of the Red Sea, into the wilderness of Sinai, through the River Jordan, into Canaan's land. Canaan's land being likened to the most holy place, the River Jordan being likened to the second veil in our tabernacle. The wilderness of Sinai is likened to the holy place because of Israel was always in light. They ate manna, and Moses was the mediator, which represents the altar of incense. You see, the Red Sea, which is the first department of veil, which is represented in your tabernacle, which, of course, is the door right here, in that it tunneled up so they can make an entryway into the wilderness, of course, from the land of Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
All right? And, of course, Egypt represents darkness, you see, or represents the court round about, because in order for them to get out, remember, in order for something to live, something has to die.
That's right.
There has to be a sacrifice.
Amen.
But Yahweh told them to offer up a lamb.
That's right.
First. Mm-hmm. If they didn't offer up a lamb, they're going to die off with all the other Egyptians down here. He's going to kill the firstborn in every house, and that's man and beast, if you're not obedient, you see. And so therefore, they come up out of here, you see, by a mighty hand. That's why that hand is right there with the rod in his hand. Because, see, Yahshua Messiah, or Joshua the son of Nun, he's the one that's orchestrating everything down here in the land of Egypt. So if you don't understand something down here, then you look up here for the understanding. If you don't understand something up here, and talk about in heaven, you look down here for the understanding. What are you talking about? There's a lamb that was slain down here, right? So therefore, if there's a lamb slain down here, there got to be the lamb slain from the foundation of the world, which is Yahweh Elohim. There's a tabernacle that was built down here in the wilderness. Why? Because there's a tabernacle up here in heaven. You follow me? There was light down here in Goshen. You see that? So there had to be light here on the first day.
That's right.
This thing right here with the sea is representative of chaosis. Right? Because it was chaotic down here. It was. You understand what I'm saying? You got to see the same thing going down here on earth that's going on in heaven. You see? So then so if there was light here, there's light in Goshen, there's the Red Sea, because it was a three-day journey to the Red Sea. Isn't that right? Then Abraham's seed went through on dry land, which lines up with your third day of creation right here. You get the point I'm trying to make? What's ever going on up here in heaven, it has to be made manifest down there. So you just flip it up in the spirit, or you flip it down in the flesh to get it understand. But you got to line them up as they're coming on down, if it making any sense. Now, as Abraham's seed is going through, you see, be mindful of the fact that was some 600,000, not counting 603,550 fighting men.
Right.
It was a mixed multitude, not counting women and children.
Right.
When we talk about the 600.
Right.
But there was still the principle is there was approximately 600,000.
Yeah.
You see, coming through, not counting women and children.
Right.
Because when the man comes in on the sixth day, falling from the dust of the earth, there were no women and children.
Right.
They was in his loins.
That's right.
So you just flipping it right on up.
Mm-hmm.
That it was animals here, there's animals there. You see?
Yeah.
There was fish in the sea here, there's fish in the sea here, there's fish in the sea there. You got to see it all.
Yeah.
You got to just flip it right on up. And there's other principles, but I just point out a few. You see? How Yahweh is carrying out his purpose, but there's a man always present.
Yeah.
In each one of those days. Him being first, and then he formed the man.
Mm-hmm.
Alright? Now, I'm going to shut it down right there. We can finish up, go back into this on Thursday. I hope and trust you guys got something I was saying.
Very good.
I never got to 2 Peter, but maybe I'll pick it up on Thursday. All right? Hallelujah. All
right. Okay, thank you for that. That concludes tonight's workshop. Any announcements? Dr. Kenaway and Will Williams are on their way up to Chicago for their seminar out there. They'll be back in a couple of weeks. Okay. Also, I want to send a shout out to Helen and what's her niece? Karina out there in Ensenada. She got in touch with me last Saturday. So hopefully they'll be watching. Okay, and we'll go down there and visit them too also. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser, our treasurer. We have classes here Sundays 11 to 1, Tuesday, Thursday, 7:30, 9:30. Okay, also have an open invitation to come out. If you're in the Southern California area, come and visit our class. Okay, it's Ontario, California. I'll give you the address right here. It's 1816 Alma Court. Okay, Ontario, California, 91764. You got a telephone number, it's Dr. Joe Williams, the dean. You can contact him at area code 909-821-4434. Okay, so hopefully we come out, we got plenty of seats. Okay, we have a Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month. Those that speak Spanish, come out, help out with the class, we can grow a little bit. You can bring your questions, because I know there's a lot of questions out there. And we got answers, okay?
Yeah.
So with that, let's all stand be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, for that you fall from his presence with exceeding joy. So otherwise, Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua, our Sovereign, we love glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let's all say,
Hallelujah.
Great class, Joe. Great class.
Yes, it was.
Some more than others, but all. Would it make any sense to say how close we are to Ontario Airport? What are we, like a mile or so?
Yeah. Less than that. Matter of fact, less than that, because Ontario Airport is right over the right across Vineyard.
You say we're walking distance from Ontario?
Yeah, we really are, because it's right here. Because Vineyard is right here, and Hope is right here. So once you go to the corner, you make a right turn, you land at the airport.
Yeah. Oh,
literally.
Yeah, you can stop there.
Yeah, you can stop. I have this one.